Hello, my dear friends. I welcome you all to our channel, Best Notes Tutorials. And today we are going to learn MCQs from day 18. I hope you all are revising and practicing a lot. If you require any kind of help, just send us in the comment section and tell us how you all are finding our videos. Let's begin with question number one. Which American poet, also known for his short stories, wrote a touching love poem that goes something like the following. It was many and many a year ago, in a kingdom by the sea, that a maiden there lived, whom you may know, and whose hotness you could probably see. Your options are Option A, O. Henry. Option B, Jack London. Option C, Nathaniel Hawthorne. Option D, Edgar Allan Poe. So here, option D is correct. That is Edgar Allan Poe. Let's see the highlighters. In his influential essay, The Philosophy of Composition, Edgar Allan Poe proclaimed that the death of beautiful women is the most beautiful topic in the world. Small wonder then that some of his best known poetry, including Annabel Lee, reproduced above in modified form, and The Raven, are told by a speaker who has just experienced the death of a lover. Let's go through the highlighters of the answer. In his influential essay, The Philosophy of Composition, Edgar Allan Poe proclaimed that the death of a beautiful woman is the most beautiful topic in the world. Small wonder then that some of his best-known poetry, including Annabel Lee and Raven, are told by a speaker who has just experienced the death of a lover. For all his scary short stories and heart-aching love poetry, Poe was also an important literary critic. In the Poetic Principle, the Baltimore native rejected the idea of the fireside authors and their narrative poetic epics. Similarly, he explained the idea of a unity of effect present in a poem or a story, which restricts the length of reading to a single sitting so that the reader can comprehend the whole work in one go. Allan Poe only ever wrote one novel, The Narrative of Arthur Gordon Pym of Nantucket, which was published anonymously, preferring to make a name for himself with shorter works. Let's move to question number two. Which author's terza rima is usually a bit more elegant than the sample love poem that I have produced below? The lines are, I love you, my dear, so much, and not just because you are so hot, though that is true as such. Your options are Dante, Ovid, Petrarch, and Catullus. Here, option A, that is Dante, is correct option. For good reason, the terza rima style is inextricably linked to Dante, who used it throughout his masterpiece Divine Comedy, itself composed of three parts, Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso. The style uses an interlocking rhyme scheme ABA, CBB, sorry, BCB, D, sorry, CDC, and DED. And although it has been applied since, notably by Percy Shelley and Robert Frost, the origin lies with the Florentine master. Literary critics say that the rhyme scheme propels the narrative along tarset by tarset as Dante progresses deeper and deeper into hell. The terza rima also proposes additional challenges for translators, since it is not an easy form to mimic while safeguarding meaning. The original Divine Comedy was written in Italian, not Latin, which was a pretty big deal for the 14th century. Some translators of the epic, like Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, well known as H.W. Longfellow, didn't even try to imitate it. Definitive translations into English maintaining Dante's meter include version by Dorothy Sayers and Robert Pinsky. Question number 3. Which Victorian poet's most famous work ends with a slightly more artistic flourish than the cheap love poetry reproduced below? As it is you alone who lights my darkling plain, you are unbelievably outrageously hot, and that in spite of any ignorant armies who clash by night. So here your options are Gerald Manley Hopkins, Alfred Lord Tennyson, Matthew Arnold, and option D, John Keats. Here option C is correct, that is Matthew Arnold. Let's go through the highlighters to understand the option better. Correct option better. One of my all-time favorite poems, and also one of the all-time most heavily anthologized poems, Matthew Arnold's Dover Beach, is equal parts love song and song of despair. Arnold's speaker laments the eternal note of sadness that can be heard at the cliff of Dover, caused by the ebbing of the sea of faith. Modern technology and ideas have unveiled the naked shingles of the world, and the speaker proclaims that the world, which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so famous, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither enjoy nor love nor light. Ray Bradbury quoted the poem in Fahrenheit 451, a novel tackling similar themes of despair and the loss of interpersonal connections due to modern technologies. Question number 4. Which modern American poet undoubtedly could have penned the following lines of love poetry? I carry your hot heart with me. I carry it in my heart. I am never without it. Anywhere I go, you go, my dear. And wherever you are, I follow, because you are so unbelievably hot. I carry your heart. I carry it in my heart. Here your options are Ezra Pound, Wallace Stevens, Edward Estling Cummings, and option D, William Carlos Williams. Here your correct option is option C, Edward Estling Cummings. Let's see the highlighters. Edward Estling Cummings, or as is often preferred, E.E. Cummings, evidently earns his principal rank among the modernists for his beautiful love poetry and not for his capitalization abilities. Like all the good modernists, he serves as an ambulance driver in World War I, during which he was captured by the French and imprisoned. That experience informed his breakout novel, The Enormous Room. Nevertheless, it is the poetry that Cummings wrote after the war that really stand out. Iconic verses like "Anyone lived in a pretty now town," or "Somewhere I have never traveled, gladly beyond," or the poem "That I have butchered, I carry your heart with me." Question number 5. Had we but world enough and time, this coyness, lady, would be no crime, as it is dear, your hotness does make this coyness a grand mistake. Which 17th century British poet offered a much more convincing show of his love and in to his coy mistress than what I have provided above? Option A, Oscar Wilde. Option B, John Milton. Option C, William Blake. And option D, Andrew Marvell. Here it is option D, that is Andrew Marvell, who penned to his coy mistress where he is trying to coo his mistress. "To his coy mistress" is probably the most famous verse of Andrew Marvell, who wrote most of his politically tinged poetry around the time of Oliver Cromwell. This one isn't political, though most scholars would agree that it fits the genre of a carpe diem, poetry urging the speaker's love to seize the day. Iconic phrases like "Time's winged chariot" and "Graves a fine and private place" originates with this poem. Marvell, along with his good friend John Milton, was a good politician too. During one of England's most chaotic epochs, he managed to write state-sponsored poetry under both Charles I and II and under Cromwell II. Another of his best-known poems, "Upon Appleton House," was written at the namesake estate of Thomas Fairfax, a leader of the parliamentarians. Marvell also wrote a highly praised and objective Horatian ode after Cromwell's notorious campaign in Ireland. Let's move to question number 6. It would be rather tedious to go through the entire poem, but who might have written her best known poem to husband Robert in the far less melodious version below? "How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. Way 1, you are so hot and that is great. Way 2, you are so hot and hold my gaze. Way 3, you are so hot as though it is faith." Here your options are Mary Shelley, Elizabeth Bennet Browning, Christina Rossetti, and Emily Bronte. So here your option is correct option is option B, Elizabeth Barrett Browning. Let's see the highlighters. Elizabeth Barrett Browning is largely remembered today for Sonnet 43 out of her 44 poem collection, Sonnets from the Portuguese, which begins, "How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. I love thee to the depth and breadth and height my soul can reach when feeling out of sight for the end of being and ideal grace." Robert Browning, also a great poet, convinced Elizabeth to publish Sonnets from the Portuguese, convinced that it was the best sonnet sequence in centuries. He also inspired the collection's name, having given Elizabeth the nickname the Portuguese due to her work, due to her dark complexion. E. Browning is also known for the verse novel in 9 books titled Aurora Leigh, which was published in 1856. Question number 7. For God's sake, hold your tongue and let me love. Speak, and your hotness shall lose what I speak of. As virtuous men pass mildly away, there remains only this left to say. Which English author's collected works could accurately be summarized in the crude love poem above? John Donne, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, William Butler Yeats, and Charles Baudelaire. Here, option A, that is John Donne, is correct answer. Let's see the highlighters. John Donne poems, including The Canonization and A Valediction Forbidding Mourning, the Englishman who lived around the turn of the 17th century, is known today as the foremost representative of the metaphysical poets, a group that also included Andrew Marvell, and believed that every poem ever should be about love or lust. But many of Donne's best known poems have these common extended metaphor or conceits. When Donne wasn't busy writing secretly R-rated poetry, he also penned the Holy Sonnet, a collection of 30 poems published posthumously in 1633. These poems, which include such titles as Better My Heart, Three Personed God, and Death, Be Not Proud, secured the author's reputation not just as a love poet, but also one capable of writing serious verse. Question number 8. When a lover is a beggar, abject is that dash. Here, your options are voice, option B, knee, option C, face, and option D, hand. So here, when a lover is a beggar, abject is his knee. Okay. This poem, when a lover is a beggar, line 1314, is a piece of feminist literature written by Dickinson in 1878 at the age of 48. It could, of course, be seen as sour grapes, as Dickinson was never married, but it still makes some interesting observation that could still be seen as valid at the time of its first publishing in 1945 and even yet today. As all the heavens were a bell and dash but an ear. Here, option A, B, me, option B, creation, option C, myself, option D, being. As all the heavens were a bell and being but an ear is the correct option. Here, being is the correct answer. This quotation is from I Felt a Funeral in My Brain, line 280. It makes a great metaphor for revelation and paradigm shift. Although it was written in 1861, 11 years after her earliest known poem, this piece of verse can still be seen as an early work, for her writing did not become particularly prolific until the end of 1858, just 3 years previously. Question number 10. I heard dash when I died. Your options are, what will fill in this blank? Your options are a bell ring, a footstep, a silence, a fly budge. So here option D is correct, that is a fly budge. I heard a fly budge when I died. Line 465, written in 1862 and published in 1862 itself. Like the poem from the previous question, 10 years after her death, it is complete hopelessness it presents. The message portrayed in the verse suggests the insignificance of the death of a person, a concept that is made all more shocking by the fact that Dickinson was raised by her father very strictly within the doctrines of Christianity. Demure, you are straightway dangerous and handled with a dash. In dash, what will be appropriate? Option A, cage. Option B, care. Option C, chain. And option D, stick. So here, chain is the correct option. Much madness is divinest sense. My life's motto. The extreme statement about individualism was, outside of those few published during her lifetime, was among those of her poems that were earliest published. It was first printed in 1890, only 4 years after her death at the age of 56. Apparently, with no surprise to any happy flower, the frost dash it at its play in accidental power. Here in the blank, what will be suitable word? Destroys, beheads, chokes, and freezes. Here, apparently with no surprise to any happy flower, the frost beheads it at its play in accidental power. So here, beheads is the correct option. Let's see the highlighters. Apparently, with no surprise, the first Dickinson poem, written in 1884, near the end of Dickinson's life, this piece of verse was another of those published relatively early in 1890. I reckon when I count at all, first dash, then sun. Here in the dash, what will fit? Option A, poets. Option B, summer. Option C, God. And option D, poetry. Here in this blank, option A will go, that is poets. I reckon when I count at all, first poets, then the sun. Let's see the highlighters. I reckon when I count at all, written in 1862 and published in 1929, is a strangely paradoxical poem. As Dickinson here expresses in verse, the fact that she relates poetry to the gods, and yet she does this with no egotism. Despite the fact that she had, by the time she penned these words, produced well over 500 other poems, she proves here that she did not see herself as a poet, nor even necessarily capable of producing true poetry. Let's move to question number 14. Dash are prudent in an emergency. Here, what will fit in this dash? Bandages, thoughts, microscopes, and gentlemen. Here, your options. Option C is correct, that is microscopes. Let's see the highlighters. The poem is Faith is a Fine Invention. Line 185. This is a cute little four-liner written early in Dickinson's career and is a sarcastic little crack at what she viewed as society's deterioration of faith, of believing without seeing. This so much a joy, this so much joy, if I should dash what poverty. Here, option A is lose, option B fail, option C fall, option D die. Here, option B, that is fail, is correct option. This so much joy, if I should fail, What poverty? Highlighter says, this so much joy, this so much joy. Another early poem of Dickinson's, written in 1860 and among the number of others to receive publication in 1890, this poem is of particular note for its sophisticated use of technique. The final message of the poem is the perfect opposite of that which is sent in the opening lines. It is a poem about fear of success. Question number 18. The heart asks dash first and then excuse from pain. Option A is goodness, option B pleasure, option C happiness, and option D contentment. Here option B, that is pleasure, is correct. The heart asks pleasure first and then excuse from pain. Let's move to the highlighters. The heart asks pleasure first, line 536, written in 1862, originally published in 1890. This poem presents a bleak but poignant comment on the human condition and what we people are able to withstand. Question number 17. Dash is that shadow on the lawn. Option A, presentiment, intuition, premonition, or suspicion. Here, dash can be filled with option A, that is presentiment. Presentiment is that shadow on the lawn. Presentiment is that long shadow on the lawn, line 764. Another four-liner, this 1864 poem is a wonderful example of Dickinson's directness and her economy of words. What is the first life form Dante meets in the Inferno? Option A, a wolf. Option B, a leopard. Option C, a lion. And option D, Virgil. Here, option B is correct, that is a leopard. Highlighter says, the lion, leopard, and she-wolf block Dante from going to the Mount of Joy. It is said that they symbolize political factions active in Dante's time. It is also said that they symbolize the flaws of human nature, making it possible for this flawed human to go directly to the Mount of Joy. Question number 19. After Virgil and Dante meet up, Virgil leads Dante to a gate. There is something written on the gate. What is the first line of the message written on the gate? Option A, I am the way into the city of woe. Option B, I am a gate. I am the way to a forsaken people. Sacred justice moved by architect. Here option A is correct, that is I am the way into the city of woe. This is the line which is written on the gate. Let's see the highlighters. Here we see Virgil and Dante looking at the gate to hell. It must have been a frightening experience for the writer. Question number 20. On the purgatory, upon arriving at Peter's gate, Peter cuts how many peas in Dante's forehead for his sword? Option A, 7. Option B, 4. Option C, 5. And option D, 8. So here, he cuts 7 peas in Dante's forehead with his sword. Let's move to the highlighters. The 7 peas are said to symbolize the 7 deadly sins. After Dante sees each group of sinners and speaks to them, an angel appears and takes 1 pea from Dante's forehead. Let's move to question number 21. As Virgil and Dante go up the mountain, they meet another poet who has served his time on purgatory and is headed to paradise. What is this poet's name? Your options are Statius, option B, Beowulf, option C, Homer, and option D, Gawain. Here, option A is correct, that is Statius. Let's see the highlighters. Statius is the author of the Thebaid. His full name is Publius Pipinius and Statius. Publius Pipinius and Statius. Okay, please remember. Question number 22. In the earthly paradise, Dante sees a car pulled by what? Option A, a dragon. Option B, a griffon. Option C, a man. And option D, a giant. Here, option B is correct, that is a griffon. Highlighter says, there are a lot of fantastic creatures Dante encounters. Harpies, Geryon, and this griffon. Let's move to question number 23. In paradise, Dante has a new guide. As Virgil disappears in the earthly paradise, who is this new guide? Option A, God. Option B, Homer. Option C, Beatrice. And option D, Statius. So here, option C is correct, that is Beatrice is his new guide. Highlighter says Virgil cannot enter paradise because this place is in limbo and he is denied the joy of paradise due to his pagan belief in his life. Another reason Virgil is not Dante's guide is because Virgil symbolizes human reasoning. In paradise, one must cast off human reason and accept divine will. Beatrice symbolizes divine will. Question number 24. Who felt proud of calling themselves son of Benz? Option A, Cavalier poets. Option B, Puritan poets. Option C, Metaphysical poets. And option D, Anglican poets. So here option A is correct, that is Cavalier poets. Cavalier poet, any of a group of English gentlemen poets called cavaliers, because of their loyalty, most of them felt of calling themselves son of Benz. Question number 25. Erhon is a dash by Butler. Option A, classic epic, romantic epic, a novel, or heroic. Heroic poem. Here, option C is correct, that is, it is a novel. Erhon is a novel by Butler. Highlighter says, Erhon or Over the Range, a novel by Samuel Butler, first published anonymously in 1872, set in fictional country. By this, we have completed day 18 MCQs. We will move towards 19 day MCQ in our next class. Till then, prepare well. All the best. Thank you.